Miracle of the Rock, Our Lady of Las Lajas. If you're not familiar with this, most people are not. In fact, I wasn't familiar with it until just about like 5 years ago. This is one of those miracles that just, it's not really on the radar as far as miracles are concerned, like the Shroud of Turin or Our Lady of Fatima. This is just one of those that doesn't seem to get recognized, but that's why I wanted to make a video. What the Miracle of the Rock is, or Our Lady of Las Lajas, is the image before you was found on a rock down in Colombia, between Colombia and Ecuador. And what has baffled modern scientists is how the image is on the rock. Meaning, there is no paint, there's no dye, there's no pigment, there's no primer, there's no chemical on the rock to create such an image. How is the image on there? And that's what they can't figure out. In fact, it's the rock itself is the image. When geologists drilled into the rock 3 feet, they find the image is still there. So the image is the rock itself. That's why it's so fascinating. And again, modern scientists cannot figure out how this image got there. In addition to that, it's in Colombia. It was found in the jungles of Colombia in 1754. How is it possible that some type of paint or pigment has survived 300 years with out in the humidity of Colombia and the rain? I shouldn't say the rain, because this rock was found in a cave, but I will say the extraordinary heat and humidity, the climate of Colombia. Let me give you the backstory of this fascinating miracle. So in 1754, there is a woman by the name of Maria, very ironic, that has to travel between villages. And in her travels on this path, there is a cave. And the cave is supposedly haunted. But on one occasion, Maria has to go into the cave to find shelter from a storm. And in that occasion, she said that she felt a tap on her shoulder and a woman's voice call her name. Well, she ran from the cave in fear, never to tell anybody. Later on, Maria was going through this path again with her child, her daughter. And her child is deaf and mute. But the child went into the cave and became able to speak and was able to hear. And Maria heard her calling for her mother, saying, "Mommy, come look at the woman in white in this cave." So naturally, again, Maria picked her child up and ran back to the village and didn't tell anybody. Well, the child kept wandering back to the cave. This is very biblical. Again, some of you might remember when Jesus wandered back to the temple and Mary and Joseph were trying to go back to Galilee or trying to go back to Nazareth, and Jesus wandered to the temple. They couldn't find him. That's kind of reminiscent of this. So the child kept going back to the cave and kept seeing these Marian apparitions, these ghosts of Mary. And on several occasions, every time, her mother would find her talking to this Marian apparition. Well, later on, the child got sick and died. And Maria brought the child to the cave and prayed to Mary and said, "Could you bring the child back?" Well, the child came back to life. And then Maria's secret was no longer a secret. You can't hide a resurrected child. So naturally, when the word got out, the villagers flocked to the haunted cave, and this is what they found inside the cave, this image. You should see some similarities if you know the Bible as far as going to the cave to find this. It's very similar to Mary going to the cave on the morning of Easter and finding Jesus was gone, but found the shroud. It's very kind of similar to that. The villagers, it was said that they came at dawn and found this painting to coincide basically with the Bible. So naturally, this became a pilgrimage site for people to come give homage and to pray before these images. So they built a church on top of it. Now, this church is built into the side of the mountain, but it's built right on top of this rock. So it's still standing outside to the elements, which should give, you know, further evidence. This rock is still out there. And then building a church on top of the rock, if you know your Bible, that's Matthew chapter 16, when Jesus says to Peter, "And you, Peter, on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will never overcome it." So building your church on top of this rock does seem very biblical. So in the years after following, there have been countless numbers of miracles. In fact, what they say is that inside the church, there are metal plaques along the walls, and they say that the walls are filled with these metal plaques from people who have experienced miracles, so much that the church had to tell the people to stop leaving your wheelchairs and crutches and medical supplies out near the church because it was becoming like a medical supply graveyard, and it was becoming a junkyard. So those miracles keep happening to people who visit this site. So it's a wonderful story. I love the fact that today's scientists cannot figure it out, and they've been stumped again by some peasant of 18th or 16th century. It's so common to other miracle stories. As far as the image itself, very similar to the image of Our Lady of Guadalupe, which is a painting in Mexico from the 1550s, Juan Diego. It's a similar story. Painting is similar. They can't figure out. That's a painting that's on a cloth, a very cheap fabric that most people say, scientists say, you know, the painting should not have survived 7 years, much less 500, and that is still on display. But the paintings themselves, or the images themselves, are very similar. Both show Mary, a black-haired woman, long black hair, both in blue cloaks, covered in a blue cloak with the stars on them. That's biblical. That's Revelation chapter 12. It's not a in Revelation chapter 12, Mary is shown as wearing a crown of stars and standing on the moon. Here, she's got a cloak of stars and standing on a crescent moon. So that's very biblical. The color theme of the red underneath with the blue, you see red and blue in a lot of images like this. The Divine Mercy, that's a painting from 1930s, that's St. Faustina, that had the red and the blue. Our Lady of Guadalupe, the red and the blue. You see the red and the blue a lot. And referring to the Bible, that is much like John chapter 2, the wedding of Cana, when Jesus turned the water into wine. It also is reminiscent of John chapter 19, when the soldier stabs Jesus in the side. What flows from the wound is blood and water. So this image is not the only image that we have where Mary is wearing a blue cloak with stars and a red tunic. The two saints before her praying are St. Francis and St. Dominic. Dominic is the one receiving the rosary, where Francis is the, where it looks like the child is handing, or looking down at Francis, extending him a cord. And then lastly, the most interesting part of this image is the portrayal of Jesus as a child. Now, if this is a miracle, it's interesting to think that heaven portrayed Jesus as a child. And my assumption with that is, if Jesus was a man, what does that do to Mary's significance or Mary's role. If Mary's holding the baby or the boy Jesus, doesn't that heighten Mary's significance, her importance, her relevance into the salvation story? You know, in the Bible, when Mary goes to Elizabeth, it's found in Luke chapter 1. We Catholics get the Hail Mary prayer directly out of the Bible in Luke 1. But in Mary's song or her conversation with Elizabeth, she says, "My soul magnifies the Lord." And this image is magnifying Mary's significance in salvation. She is the medium for providing the King of salvation. Her importance in the role cannot be denied when she, her image, her apparitions show up throughout time all over the place. And it's almost like heaven is putting a spotlight on Mary. So that portraying Jesus even heightens that awareness, that importance, that significance, that relevance. So I hope you found this video interesting, fascinating. If this kind of thing is if this kind of thing is interesting to you, I have a course on Udemy. I'll put it in the description. But other than that, I hope this has increased your faith. Thank you for watching.